watching live this morning. Good morning. Kirsten, you are watching live from the room. That's always exciting. DJ Shelton. She said we're not on YouTube yet, but on the way. Should be now. Walt Baker, good morning, Walt. Sharon and Trina, good morning. Good to see you. Aaron Kaplan, we love you back. Rose, Randy Spolstra, watching from the back. By the way, good morning, everybody who's in the room. Good to see you. Yeah, or raise their hand, whatever they like, whatever they want to do. All right, we're starting a minute early. I see you there. I was like seeing the Colucci's on our video. Moved you up, huh? Got you moved up. Peggy, you're guarding the corner. Good morning, Alan and Linda. I hope you're not getting another hurricane. They've had three. They moved and got three hurricanes. See what you get? Try to move away from us.
Man, you morning people. No, I'm serious.
Well, good morning. Oh, boy. You know, it's later than it was 2 weeks ago.
I know.
And it throws up. But we're going to try it again. All right. I'll give you another chance. Good morning.
Good morning.
Much better. It is great to see you guys this morning. Some of the guys, I'm so glad you have your masks on, but it has nothing to do with having your mask on. It's just nice not to see your face. It's just the way it is. I've had wives tell me that. They love it when their husband has a mask on. He looks so much better. So, and we're working on Brad Pitt masks. Is that who it is, Brad Pitt? I don't know who's popular. Tom Hanks? I don't know.
Oh, yeah.
Who's popular now?
All those guys.
Who? Shamar?
Shamar Moore.
I have no idea who that is. See, I'm out of it. I'm old. As you're going to find out today when I talk about Atari. Yeah, you're going to be like, what is Atari? Anyway, but we're glad you're here this morning. We're starting a new series today on social media. And whether you're on social media or not, I want you to know that it's impacting your life. And it's impacting people in your life. It's impacting your kids, your grandkids, your neighbors. And if you are on social media, I'm going to give you some practical tips so that you can quit gaining the world and losing your soul. And I think that's going to be my key verse for this series, is that we gain the whole world on social media, but we're losing our soul. And so I want to make sure we get back to what really matters. Nothing wrong. Social media is not evil, but how we use it sometimes is. So let's go to the Lord in prayer this morning. Father, thank you for each one here. We thank you especially this weekend for our veterans, for those who serve and are serving and who have served. We are so grateful. Father, I thank you, too, for a church that loves and cares about people. I thank you for all the visitors who came last night and told me how loved and accepted they felt when they showed up at our church. I pray that would always be true, that we would love people right where they are, but love them too much to leave them there, that we could all move forward knowing you more each day. Lord, I pray as we sing songs of praise that we could withdraw from the world all the focus the world tries to get us on, all the things that are less important than you, and that we would remember, Father, that you are King of Kings and Lord of Lords, and that we would remember today as we sing songs of worship that, Father, you are the one that we should worship. You're the one we look for to save us. And so, Father, today we push aside our victories, we push aside our defeats to worship you. Thank you for these moments. Thank you for each one that serves. Thank you for all those here this morning. Bless them in Jesus' name. Amen. So Dave hates it when I introduce him. So I'd like to introduce the craziest person in this room, Bob, and the praise team.
Yeah. awesome. That's awesome. Bobby Sticks, that's what we call him up there on the drums, Bobby Sticks. Okay, come back later. Hey, what do you know what? Let's all stand up and let's sing. You know, we're going to do a song that we've done before, but normally we do it at the end of the service, so we do a little short, abbreviated version. But this time we're going to kick it off with this song, and the band is excited because we're going to play the whole song. So, yeah, the band, well, some of the band are excited. The rest of the band are terrified. But that's okay. No pressure. We're just being watched by hundreds of people. So, so we're going to sing God of Wonders. Go ahead, Ernie. Of all creation, of water, earth, and sky, the heavens are your tabernacle. Glory to the Lord on high, God of wonders beyond our galaxy. You are song. I love it. All right. Well, so the announcements are coming after me, right? But isn't Veterans Day coming up? here in the next week or so. It makes me think of a story. Now, this is a joke. It's a real joke, and I'm not pretending like it's not a joke. This is a joke. But it was a cute joke, and it's a church joke, and I thought it was cool. I should share it. This little boy, you know, sometimes if you used to go to, like, the old Baptist churches around the South, you know, out in the lobby, they would have, like, you know, a placard that would kind of, like, have the names of all the people who died in the service that were associated with that church, and they kind of honor them with that, you know, on the little sign out in the lobby. And one day there was a little boy, and he was staring up at that placard at the names, and the pastor walked by and stopped and said, "Son, do you know what those are?" And he said, "No." And he says, "Those are all the people who died in service." And he goes, "Wow, which one, the 9 o'clock or the 11? Isn't that cute? It's just a cute joke. Thank you. I didn't come up with that. It's been around for 100 years. So anyway, why don't you guys greet each other? You guys look so good today. You know that? It looks, tell your neighbor how good they look today.
There is a call. Some hear it like a distant thunder. Some hear it like a whisper in the ear. Some just feel it in their hearts. A deep sense of responsibility to country, to service, to something bigger than themselves. We honor those who are willing to do what so few have done because of their sacrifice and service. Our country is a light on the hill that cannot be put out. Though many have tried, those who stand and protect it are heroes, worthy of our respect and admiration, worthy of every minute of attention we give to pause and recognize the hope, the sacrifice, the honor of all who have served our country.
Okay, I was not aware of that, so I apologize for that. This coming Wednesday is the 11th, if I did my math right, and that would be Veterans Day. If you served, please stand and have your family stand with you because their sacrifice is almost equal to yours in our eyes because they were just as dedicated to that time frame. We won't ask which war, just being nice, okay? Operation Christmas Child, if you were one that doesn't know what day it is or what month or what year, you can still get a box, but you have to promise that you will get it back here by next Sunday because that is the absolute drop-dead deadline. But these are available out in the cafe area. We are sitting, get this, drum roll, 310 boxes so far, which is awesome. Little late, but that's great, Bob. I just don't even know where to go from that one. But anyway, we'll go to the other side. Grief shares. Sharing the holidays will be November 15th at 1 o'clock in the Family Center next door. This is an easy time of year for a lot of us, but for some of us that have lost people this year, not so much. It's a reminder And every holiday that you go through, the first one after you lose somebody, you all know what it's like. So if you know someone or you are someone, please come on November 15th at 1 o'clock. Coco Boys and Girls Club. This is a big deal. We've done this, I think, every year for I don't even know how long. Garden Project. If you don't know where that is, it's on Dixon Boulevard down in Coco. We will meet Saturday, November 21st from 8 to 12 noon at 814 Dixon Boulevard. Bring your rakes, shovels, please bring gloves. You will regret it if you don't. And lots of water. We will also be collecting money for mulch. If you would like to donate, just make a notation in your little checkbook that says Boys and Girls Club when you give. Sign up, and the sign-up sheet is at the information table where you came in to the sanctuary. And mark your calendar. Hanging of the Greens will be on Sunday, November 29th, following second service. So if you come to first service, just make a difference and come in second service and stay and hang the greens, because from what I hear, it's a lot of fun. Thanks so much.
Good morning.
Good morning.
All right, there we go. Good morning, Surfside. I am back again. How are y'all doing this morning?
Good.
Good, good, good. Some of you guys might be jubilant this morning. Some of you may not be. A lot of times it has to do with feelings. And today's message that Pastor Eric's going to go into about how we're manipulated by the media and a lot of other influences is pretty poignant and pretty relevant to us today. The opening message for him today that I'm going to try to go through really quickly here, it's kind of relevant to my life and to a lot of you lives as far as a lot of things that's going on right now. Real quick, Proverbs 3:5. Trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not onto your own understanding. Remember, it's not about feelings. There's a plan. God's got it. I was driving in to work the other day, and, you know, some of us are happy, some of us are despondent about a lot of the things that are going on in our lives, in the country, and the things that are going on in the world. And I saw a sign that somebody just put up on the side of the road, and it just kind of stuck out to me. It said, don't give up. And I was like, wow, that's kind of poignant for a lot of the stuff that's going on right now. No more, no less. It wasn't a company sign or anything. It's just a little white sign said, don't give up. And a lot of things start going through my mind about what am I supposed to not give up about? Am I supposed to not give up about the world, myself, God, my life, or what? A lot of personal things start to go through my mind. So whether I'm happy or sad, it got me thinking also about when I'm talking to my friends, how do I approach my friends about conversations when it comes to social media and, you know, me caring about them and how they feel. And a lot of times I open conversations with my friends. I'll look at a buddy of mine and I'll go, what would you change? You know, no preference to it or anything. And most of the times, they're intelligent enough to know, what are you talking about? And, you know, but if they're really emotional about it, they'll go, well, I'll change this about that. It's like, well, wait a minute. And it kind of opens up a snapshot into how are you being affected by the things that's emotionally affecting you right now. And we'll have this little bit of a dialogue that kind of gets us to go into a conversation about why are you feeling the way you're feeling right now? What's affecting you? Helps me too a lot of times. As a Christian, what's affecting us? And a lot of times with this message that we're about to go into right now with Pastor Eric, it's very relevant to us to understand the influences on the world right now and why we're being affected by that, if we're being affected at all. Real quick, and this is going to be a little bit scary. Just take a little bit of a latitude right here. I'm going to read through something real quick. My mother, who's a long-held Christian up in Atlanta. She's like almost in her 90s. I read this to her and kind of scared her to death. I didn't mean to scare her. And she's like, I didn't know it said that in the Bible. I said, yeah, it did. I said, this is God speaking to a guy named Job. Now, I won't read the whole thing, but I'll read a few passages. Now, this, some of the people know the story of Job. Job was a guy who had it all, lost it all, and he got it back. But at his lowest point, you know, his friends were trying to say he had done this, did this, and this was the reason why he lost everything. But this was God, opening statement, talking to Job. Job was despondent down, and he was starting to feel a certain way about stuff, and he started to question God. Real quick, Job 38. Then the Lord spoke to Job out of the storm, and he said, who is this that obscures my plans with words without knowledge? Brace yourself like a man. I will question you, and you shall answer me. Where were you when I laid the foundations of the earth? Tell me if you understand. Who marked off its dimensions? Surely you know. Who stretched and measured the line across it? On what were its footings set? Or where were the cornerstones while the morning stars sang together and all the angels shouted for joy? Who shut up the seas behind the doors when it burst forth from the womb? When I made the clouds its garment and wrapped in its thick darkness? When I fixed the limits in its place and set the doors and bars in place? When I said, this far you may come and no further. And it goes on. And he continues to ask Job a series of questions, basically saying, I am God. I made you and everything in creation. I know the plans I have for you and the rest of creation. And that still holds true today, even in the midst of a lot of the things that are going on right now. So we need to trust him and understand what is going on and why in this world we're being subtly influenced in the ways that we are. Some of the smartest people I know have no formal education. The smartest people I personally know myself are the listeners, the ones who sit back and they understand enough to try to digest the information. As Christians, we get information in, and we try to peacefully figure out in a patient kind of way, how is this going to best serve not just our needs, but God's needs in a patient kind of way. And this message that Eric is about to bring to us today is going to guide us down that path. But above all things, remember what Ephesians 6:12 tells us. It says, for we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against powers and principalities, against the rulers of darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. That's what we need to be cognizant of today in this world as Christians. This is not heaven. Our hope is heaven. And this is not to scare you. All we're here to do right now, and this is what Pastor Eric is trying to help us to become aware of, are the influences that are trying to pull us away from the hope of heaven and God and Christ, not to forget it. So don't put your hopes and your feelings in the materialistic stuff that's here today. So on that note, let's say a quick prayer, and I will turn it over to Pastor Eric. Thank you, Lord, for Pastor Eric. Thank you for this new message about the influences that try to pull us away from you. Help to keep us cognizant and not to be overly distracted from the cross and from the things that bring us closer to you and the hope of going home one day. In Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, thank you for your message to us each and every day. Amen.
Amen. Thank you so much, Riley. We appreciate that. Let's stand and let's continue to sing. We're going to sing I Waited. I promise I'll let you sit down on the third song. I waited for the Lord on high. Bobby off guard there. Okay, you can sit down just like I promised. Thank you. Thank you for singing. Appreciate it.
You get rewarded by hearts, likes, thumbs up. And we conflate that with value, and we conflate it with truth.
A whole generation is more anxious, more depressed.
I always felt like fundamentally it was a force for good. I don't know if I feel that way anymore.
I killed him myself.
Then why is there fear behind your eyes?
Give us the gate key.
I have no gate key. Fessick,
tear his arms off.
Oh, you mean this gate key?
Well, good morning. So, the Dread Pirate Rob. How many of you have seen that movie? What is it? Princess Bride? By the way, I felt so good. There was a mom with two teenage children, and I got home, and I looked on Facebook, which seems to be the opposite of this sermon, but I'll talk about that in a minute, and she posted a picture of she was showing her kids that movie. So, you know, I've had an impact on somebody this weekend. It may have not been for Jesus yet, but we'll see what happens there. So here's the deal. The Dread Pirate Roberts is exactly what social media tries to do. Tries to make everything bigger. You know, Jesus said very simply in Mark 8:36, what good is it for somebody to gain the whole world and yet lose their soul? What good is it for you to connect with the whole world, see everybody's pictures, know what's going on every moment of the day in every country in the world, and lose what's the most important, our relationship with Christ? Now, when I was a kid, the big thing was video games. Do you remember video games? How many of you remember video games? They're still popular, but they're all on your TV now. How many remember going to an arcade? You actually went to an arcade. Okay, I see those hands. Those are my people. How many of you remember a song called Pac-Man Fever? You know, now that's the worst song ever. And students, if you're watching this online, you can get on Amazon and Google or say Pac-Man Fever, and it will play this song that we all remember, because what it talked about is this addiction that we began to have to video games, where we went and played video games, got calluses on our thumbs, and then so they started with Pac-Man and Space Invaders, and then Defender. Remember Defender with the big ball? That's like a COVID nightmare. That's like going and rubbing bowling balls in the bowling alley right now. And then there was a game called Afterburner, which was like the coolest game in the world. And then one Christmas, I remember, I opened a present, and it was an Atari. And it had cartridges, right? And I'll never forget a Christmas night, I began playing, I'm trying to think of which game it was. I think it was Missile Command. And I began playing Missile Command, and I remember my dad coming down the stairs for breakfast, and I went, oh, no, I have played a video game all night. Now, I say all that to say this. Without us even knowing it, social media, television, radio, you're consuming information constantly, and you don't even realize how much. Some of you, as you look at this series, are like, well, I'm not really on Facebook or Snapchat or Twitter or Instagram or... what's the one where they make the little clip videos, the TikTok or any of those things? You know, I'm not on any of those, so I'm not struggling with that, really. So what do you fill your mind with? What radio station do you listen to during the day? What TV do you watch during the day? What are you allowing to consume you? Because here's the deal. The world always does the same thing, and if we're not careful, we don't even realize it. I'm going to read the middle of the passage we're going to get to and show you how this happens so easily. 1 Kings 18, verse 20 and 21. We're going to get there, but I'm going to start there, and here's why. Here's what it says. Verse 20 says this. So Ahab, do we not have the note for that? So Ahab sent word throughout all Israel, thank you, and assembled the prophets on Mount Carmel. So they had at least 450 of the Baal prophets and about 400 of the other. And let me tell you what this was. See, nowadays they have something called social media influencers. You're not even aware of it. Facebook, Twitter, even Google looks at what you've done in the past and changes and manipulates you and changes what they feed you depending on what you've done in the past. This is how scary it is. We were in the mountains last week, by the way, had a great getaway. And David, you did a phenomenal job last week. We really, really appreciate it. And David talked about taking the blue pill or the red pill. And I don't remember which pill you're supposed to take, but keep your eyes on Jesus. That's all that matters. But anyway, what was happening then is these influencers were pushing the people towards Baal or towards Asherah, towards these other gods. And it was so subtle, the people didn't even notice it. How do I know that? Because listen to what happens next. So there's one prophet left. By the way, Ahab had wiped out with Jezebel a bunch of the prophets. And then it says, Elijah went before the people. So he goes before his own people, the Jewish people, and he says this, how long will you waver between two opinions? If the Lord is God, follow him. But if Baal is God, follow him. But the people said nothing. Now, that's not in the Bible on accident. It's showing us that when he spoke, the people were like, what? They were stunned. They didn't know. I'm not even sure they realized that they had been pushed towards idol worship. And this happened over and over in the lives of Israelites and over in our lives. What were your main thoughts about this week? Were they about how good God was to you? How thankful you are for all you have? How blessed we are? How much God has done for us? Or were you focused on the problems of the world? And if so, who pushed you that way? Who did you allow to lead you towards idol worship of anyone but God? Did you know that teens on average spend 10 hours a day on their phones? A day. This was a few years ago. It may be higher. Most people type, tap, and swipe their smartphones over, you ready for this? 2,600 times a day. No wonder your thumbs hurt. And when they do this, what's happening? We get dopamine. Dopamine is that feel-good drug. Dopamine is how you feel when the Patriots win. This year's been hard on you guys. I just want to let you know we're mourning for you and secretly laughing. But we're mourning. And Dolphin fans just want you to know, if you need somebody to talk about how to deal with loss, we've been dealing with it for 30 years, so we can give you lessons in how not to get frustrated over years of losing. Has nothing to do with the sermon. I don't know why I went there. But the truth is, when you're on social media, what does it do? It gives you a temporary high. So what happens? We start to seek that high, that instant gratification, that thing that goes on. And here's what I want to encourage you to do today. I want to encourage you to plan a weekly phone or media Sabbath. Now, maybe you can't do a full day Sabbath. I understand some people can't for whatever reason. Maybe your work requires you to have your phone, your internet, your email, Twitter, whatever. Maybe you have to keep up with the latest whatever. But I want to encourage you to at least take some time to put your phone over here and talk to somebody over here. To turn your TV off and look somebody in the face. Marriages are struggling because people are sitting back to back with phones in their hand or with the television on. And the common response in a household is, huh? When I was a kid, by the way, there was a study done. You know what the number one statement in a household was back then? Get out of the way. Because remember when you just had one TV? The number one statement was get out of the way. Now we don't even have to tell people to get out of the way. We just get them out of our way. The more screens, the better. So why are we tricked? Why are we manipulated? Why are we addicted? Because number one, we expect instant gratification. Listen, it's so bad that in 2017, USA Today did a study, and people would rather have a broken bone than a broken phone. 50% of people said they would rather have a broken arm than have their phone be broken. That's crazy. Now, the beginning of this chapter, by the way, if you want, you can. I would encourage you to take a look at 1 Kings 17 and 18. Interesting chapter. Amazing what Elijah did. New Testament, John the Baptist was considered the new Elijah. Elijah was supposed to come before the Messiah. He was that important that he was mentioned. Old Testament, New Testament, he's the one that they talked about over and over. So let's pick up the story in 1 Kings 17 and realize this. Elijah went to King Ahab, the dude who had killed a lot of prophets, and said, there's not going to be any rain till you repent. So now it had been 3.5 years. He was starting to suffer for what the king was doing. The water, the brook ran dry. He had been fed by ravens, and now he had to go somewhere else. So God told him to go, and this woman was going to take care of him, and we're going to pick up the story there. So he, talking about Elijah, went to Zarephath, and when he came to the town gate, a widow was there gathering sticks. He called to her and asked, would you bring me a little water in a jar so I may have a drink? Now listen, you know what she did? In a drought, she immediately did what he said. As she was going to get it, he called, and bring me a piece of bread. Bring me some cornbread. You know when you go to Cracker Barrel and they say you want cornbread or biscuits? What's your answer? Both. Both is the answer. I don't know what is wrong with you people. Or yes. Would you like cornbread or biscuits? Yes. And whatever you bring me, just know if you bring me two, you're going to be bringing more. So get yourself started on this path to success by bringing four to start with, because I'm going to fill myself up with biscuits and then take the food home in a box. But I'll tip you well. I will tip you well. All right. So as she was going to get it, he called, and bring me some cornbread. That's the southern version. I was trying to think of what do they eat in England? What's the thing you go and get? A scone. And bring me a scone. As surely as the Lord God lives, she replied, I don't have any bread. Only a handful of flour in a jar and a little olive oil in a jug. I'm gathering a few sticks to take home and make a meal for myself and my son that we may eat it and die. So she looks at Elijah, says, listen, my son is dying. We are starving to death. We have a handful of flour, just enough for a little bit of bread with some oil. I'm getting some sticks to cook it. And then we're going to die. And you think Elijah at this point would go, oh, I didn't realize that. Nay, nay. Listen to what Elijah says. Don't be afraid. Go home and do as you have said. Time out. Now listen. Does he have to start with that sentence? What did she just say? I'm going to go home and make bed and die. His first sentence is, yeah, don't be afraid. Go home and do what you said. What? You realize that's the first sentence? It's not that he doesn't care. Listen to what he says next. But first, make me a small loaf of bread for me from what you have and bring it to me, and then make something for yourself and your son. Why? For this is what the Lord, the God of Israel, says. The jar of flour will not be used up. The jug of oil will not run dry until the day the Lord sends rain on the land. She went away and did as Elijah had told her. Listen to this. So there was food every day for Elijah and for the woman and her family. For the jar of flour was not used up. The jug of oil did not run dry in keeping with the word of the Lord spoken by Elijah. Now listen. We love instant gratification. The Christian life always, always is about sacrifice. Listen, the Christian life is always about sacrifice and surrender. To become a Christian, you have to surrender your desires to His. So when people come to me and say, I don't think it's right that Christians don't want people to live in this lifestyle, I go, I know, it's really hard. It's almost like sacrifice. Elijah comes and says, make me bread first. Why? Because God always does that. You be obedient to me, you take the first step of faith, and then I'll take care of you. We love to see everything happen, but it's not faith if everything happens first. That's why when you don't know what's next and you get afraid, you have to say, God, I trust you with what's next. Whether it's what the doctor told you, whether it's what you're worried about at your job, whether it's what you're worried about in our country, whether it's what you're worried about in the thing, God says, why don't you just trust me? But I don't want to trust you until you give me what I want. He never gives you what you need until we walk in faith. And you have to realize, too many times when we're on social media, what do? We look at everybody else's best life, their best pictures. One of my friends confessed to me today that she had posted some pictures of her daughter and her going shopping for their wedding a few years ago. And she posted all these pictures, selfies, they were looking at dresses, and it looked like such a wonderful time. And she said, I'm just enjoying my daughter. And she said, we fought almost the whole time. And nobody knew it. So don't be fooled by people's happy, hey, how are you pictures, because they may have right before that said, suck in your gut, come on, we got things to do here. And all of us have had that Christmas picture, right, where mom was going, get in the picture right now. Seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be added to you as well. Do you know why we're losing our souls? Because we want instant gratification. We want instant news. We want instant thumbs up and likes. We want instant things the way we want them. By the way, our other problem is we don't want the news. We want the news we like. And so more and more we're saying, oh, no, no, don't tell me that. I'm going to watch that news channel that'll tell me what I want to hear. And so you got people just listening to what they want to hear. You know, the Bible talks about itchy ears, just so you know. Now, here's how to take a social break, because this is what we need, because we're gaining the whole world and losing our soul, because we are seeking approval from others instead of God. Number one, we need to learn to not fear that rejection or emptiness. They say that there are people, when they've taken their phones away, that suddenly feel depressed instantly. Your teenager, your grandson, your grandchild, your neighbor. Why is that phone such a big deal? Because that's where they're getting their love and acceptance. You know what you need to do? Give love and acceptance. Go out of your way to let them know they're loved and cared about, no matter what somebody online tells them. Number two, choose sacrifice. We have to repent of addiction. Some of us are just addicted to news. Some of us are addicted to hearing things what we want to hear all the time. Believe God. God, you love me, you convict me, but he also accepts us. Realize that God will provide for us. He'll also provide self-esteem, approval, love, and grace. And some of us need to teach that to our children and grandchildren, that regardless of what their phone says, Grandma absolutely loves you just like you are. Even when you're totally messed up and broken and make bad decisions, I still love you. I don't like you right now, but I still love you. And then you'll be able to help others. When you quit focusing on what the media is saying to you, you'll pay attention to what other people. Here's the question. Was one of your main thoughts this week how you could bless someone? Or was it doom and gloom? If it was doom and gloom, you've been affected by the media. Your children care more about what you do and what you say than what any politician will say to them or about them. Number two, we don't evaluate our manipulated addiction. We never pay attention. My aunt died of smoking. She had a stroke. She was in the hospital. A nurse gave her more cigarettes. And she, while on oxygen, was smoking cigarettes. You can tell this was a few years ago, right? So I want to show you how the cigarette companies did it because they're doing the same thing now. Look at this. Santa Claus has got his Pall Malls. Next. Next. And there we go. And the baby loves Marlboros. Next. And, of course, Bob Hope loves cigarettes. Okay, next. And don't forget, it's better to be thin than fat. By the way, I've had smokers tell me this. I can't quit smoking. I get fat. Okay, so lung cancer or heart disease? Which one you want? All right, next. Oh, yeah, Lucy and Ethel. Lucy and Ethel. Thanks a lot, Lucy and Ethel. Okay, next. Oh, and don't forget, you got a doctor who's helping you with your asthma. And then next. This is my favorite one. More doctors smoke Camels than any other cigarettes. This is what they fed us. And when anybody came and said that's not true, they hired promotional people to say all those studies are lies. Don't believe them. Why? Because they wanted to manipulate us into buying. Listen, if you think social media companies and whether you watch whatever news channel you watch, if you think they're not doing this, pay attention. When you walk into Disney World and you pass the train, does anybody know what you instantly smell? Popcorn. Did you know that? Did you know that's on purpose? And as long as you know it's on purpose and realize you're going to get hungry as soon as you walk in the park, they do that on purpose. Your media on purpose is making you nervous, scared, happy, aggravated. They're manipulating you. Don't worship them. Don't follow them. So Ahab sent word throughout all Israel and assembled the prophets on Mount Carmel. Elijah went before the people and said, "How long will you waver between two opinions?" We already read this, remember? If the Lord is God, follow him. If Baal is God, follow him. But the people said nothing. Then Elijah said to them, "I'm the only one of the Lord's prophet left, but Baal has 450 prophets." And then it goes on, "Get two bulls for us. Let Baal's prophets choose one for themselves. Let them cut it into pieces, put it on the wood, but not set fire to us. I'll prepare the other bull, put it on the wood, and not set fire to it. Then you call on the name of your God, and then I'll call on the name of my God, the Lord who answers by fire. He is God." Listen to this. Then all the people said, "What you say is good." So basically, he has a show-off dance competition, right, on Mount Carmel. It was a wrap-off. It was a fire-off. And of course, you know the story, all the prophets of Baal are running around, they're screaming, they're yelling, and he says, "Maybe your God's asleep and can't hear you, maybe you should yell louder." They start cutting themselves, they're bleeding, they're running around. Elijah comes and says, "Okay, you know, we're in the middle of a drought, but I'd like about 12 giant 50-gallon drums of water dumped on this sacrifice first. Could you go get it?" They did. And then what happened? God sent fire. At the time of the sacrifice, the prophet Elijah stepped forward and prayed, "Lord, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Israel." What was he doing? He was refocusing on who God is. When's the last time in the middle of your worry, your fear, your frustration, your aggravation, that you realized all that God has done, past tense? "Let it be known today that you are God in Israel, and I am your servant and have done all these things at your command. Answer me, Lord, answer me, so these people will know that you, Lord, are God." Listen, and that you're turning their hearts back again. This is what we need as Christians. When you and I are on social media, we should be an example of what it's like to talk and text and email and Facebook note and message and tweet what a believer would tweet. We should have WWJT. What would Jesus tweet, right? Then the fire of the Lord fell, burned up the sacrifice, the wood, the stones, and the soil, and licked up the water in the trench. So here you've got teens 10 hours a day on their devices, and they don't realize that they're being pulled away. We have adults who leave the TV on 24 hours a day to negative selling, everything selling. Listen, I love DIY Network, but they're selling you stuff. They're selling you stuff all the time. I took a picture of a bathtub on our trip. When I got home, I was on Facebook, and all of a sudden I got a Home Depot ad. You know what was on the Home Depot ad? Bathtubs. They're selling you something all the time. Now, how to remove social addiction and manipulation, because we don't even realize it. Identify who you're serving. When you're watching the TV, when you're on Facebook, when you're on Twitter, when you're on Instagram, when you're on Snapchat, what are you concerned about? Is it turning you towards God or focusing you on the world or yourself and selfishness? Evaluate the world around you using God's word. We always go back to God's word. And one of the problems is we begin worshiping everything but God. Number three, pray that others would see God's truth in your online habits. Facebook has influencers that they pay. They're just normal kids in many cases that have products. And the reason they do it is to try to influence people. Listen. If I read your tweets, if I read your Facebook notes, are you influencing people towards Christ or something else? Are your tweets and Facebook notes and the things that you say, are they uplifting and encouraging, or are they pushing people towards the world and what matters in the world more? Number four, be willing to share so that others can turn their hearts towards God. Realize that Elijah was putting himself in harm's way to say to people, God is God. Don't pay attention to these other voices. And if you begin to say, God, would you use me? Lord, use the social media that I have to push people towards you. You know what was wonderful about last night? When I got home, we had three visitors. They sat right here, a mom and two kids. When I got home last night, I always get on Facebook and thank people and try to say hi to people. When I got on Facebook, that mom posted, went to church tonight for the first time, had a great time, felt safe because everybody wore a mask and was separated from each other, and I thought, oh, that's good. I know her mom has diabetes, and she's nervous about getting it and getting her mom sick. And she said, had a great time at Surfside Community Fellowship. One of her friends right underneath there said, I've been looking for a good church. Maybe I'll come with you next week. Somebody from our church said, I didn't know you went to Surfside last night. That's wonderful. Do you see how what the enemy uses for evil, God can use for good? So look for those opportunities to let God use what he's given you. Finally, expect fear and discouragement in victory. When you begin to put away your device, when you begin to turn off the TV and the radio and you have a little quiet with your own thoughts, it can be scary and lonely. How do I know that? Listen to what happened to Elijah. He had just done this great thing. So Jezebel sent a messenger to Elijah to say, will you guys give me 5 extra minutes today? Is that okay with everybody? Will you guys online give me 5 extra minutes? Is that okay? They said okay. Okay, good. So Jezebel sent a messenger to Elijah to say, may the gods deal with me, be it ever so severely, if by this time tomorrow I do not make your life like that of one of them. Talking about all the prophets that have been killed. Baal. Elijah was afraid. This guy just did a miracle where fire came from God, consumed a water-wet bowl. I mean, couldn't he have just said, show up, Jezebel, that's fine. Okay, God, fire part two. But what happened? He did what we do. He got his eyes on the wrong thing. He had done so well, and then what happened? He focused on the wrong thing. We do it every day. Every day. Haven't you ever had a quiet time, and then you get in the car, praise Jesus, they cut you off. You sound like Yosemite Sam all of a sudden, right? It's that long. You're having a great day, and somebody says something to you, and all you can think about is, what did they mean by that? Do you see how quick we are? Elijah was afraid. He ran for his life. When he came to Beersheba in Judah, he left his servant there. What did he do? Sometimes when we get discouraged, the first thing we do is push people away. And it's exactly what we need as people, and yet we push them away. When he went his day's journey into the wilderness, he came to a broom bush, sat down under it, and prayed that he might die. I've had enough, Lord. Take my life. I'm no better than my ancestors. Then he lay down under a bush, fell asleep, and an angel of the Lord touched him and said, get up and eat. I'll never forget, years ago, we'd go on youth trips. By the way, I'm not going to read the last practical tips. You guys can look at that. I remember going on a youth trip years ago when I was youth pastor. This was before devices. But they had Walkmans and boom boxes. This tells you I'm old. I'm just showing you how old I am. I'll show you what an Atari is one day. And I remember saying to the kids, hey, hey, give me your devices. You cannot take those to camp with you. Do you remember those days? And they would give me, and I'm telling you, these kids did not know what to do. We would get on the bus. Talk about the evil eye. Believe I should take my device. I was got my best Van Halen was in my Walkman. I was ready to go. I had my little headphones ready. I was just going to. You know what happened an hour later? They were starting to detox. Students started talking to each other. Kids would go to camp. They'd listen to the camp speaker. They'd hear God's word. And by the end of the week, you know what? Lives were radically changed. Why? Because they pulled away from the world and they spent time in God's word and hearing his word, and it changed them. But you know what would happen a week later? They would find their devices again. It's exactly what happens today. It's not just our phones. It's our radios. It's our TVs. It's even in our cars. We are afraid to turn off the radio and just be silent and let God speak to us. I want to encourage you. Have a Sabbath. If it's an hour, you can set the timer on your phone and put it in the other room if you want. If it's an hour without your TV, while you're awake. If it's an hour without your radio in the car, oh, what will I do? Pretend it's broken. And refocus on God, especially this month. Take some time to be thankful and grateful for all God has given you. If you're here today or you're watching online and you've never given your life to Jesus Christ, you can do that today. Because here's the deal. The world is always going to pull you towards negativity and selfishness and self-centeredness. And Jesus said, I gave everything. I sacrificed my life for you. And when you say, Jesus, I'm a sinner. I'm broken. I'm messed up. My desires are wrong. My thoughts are wrong. I surrender my sin and my sinful life to you. And I want to follow you. The Bible says when you choose to follow him, knowing that he died and rose again for your sins, that the great exchange takes place and Jesus gives you his life as you die to yourself. And he fills you with his Holy Spirit so that you can see beyond. So that while I was talking today and I said certain things, the Holy Spirit whispered in your ear, that's what you need to do. That's what you need to make right. So my prayer for each of us, as we look at our world that's being pushed towards Baal, that we would be able to pull back. And instead of gaining the whole world, that we would gain our soul back and the spirit from the Lord. So if you're here today and you want to give your life to Christ, I'd love to talk to you after the service. If you're online, you can send us a note. We normally do our offering right now, but we do have an offering box right now. And so you can give or you can give online for those of you who are giving online. And we appreciate that. Thanks for being here this morning. My prayer is that God will give you one or two things that you can work on in your life today. Let's pray. Father, I pray that just as the people of Israel turned from you because of all the bad influences, Lord, just like they turned from you, I know that there are influences in the world that their main goal is to turn our hearts and minds towards other things besides you. So, Father, right now, Lord, make us aware of the manipulation that goes on around us. Make us aware how our selfishness pulls us into these things. And Father, help us to repent of our self-centeredness. and Lord, to turn towards you, knowing that you will give us the power and the strength to think of others, to be a blessing in a world that's full of darkness, to be light in a world that has no salt, that we would be salt to the world. Father, I pray if there's anyone here who doesn't know you, that today would be the day they surrender their hearts and minds to you. Lord, turn all of our hearts back towards you. In Jesus' name, amen. We have a great song to close our service today. I hope you enjoy it. Thanks for coming. Close in prayer today. Father, thank you so much for each one here, each one watching online. I pray, pull our hearts and minds towards you. In Jesus' name, amen. Thanks for coming. Thanks for giving me an extra few minutes, those watching online. God bless you and keep you. Have a great week.